Hello, everyone. Am I audible? Okay. So, thanks for coming. So, myself, I am Manivannan, and I have my colleague Somashekar with me. So, we are both part of a developer experience team at PayPal, where we build end-to-end experience for all the developers at PayPal. And one of our responsibilities is to provide a continuous integration environment for all the developers at PayPal. So in this talk, I'm just going to discuss about how we started our continuous integration journey and how we used to operate and how we evolved over the time and how the efficiency improved using Mesos and Docker containers. So at PayPal, as you see here, we take continuous integration very seriously. So every line of code that is written in PayPal goes through the continuous integration process where the code is built and unit tests are run, and on top of it, there are automation tests which are run, and then it goes to production. Not even a single line of code goes to production without going through our continuous integration process. So before I go on, how many of you use Jenkins? Okay, that's good. And how many of you tried Mesos? Okay, thank you. So I should be careful about what I speak. I think I have a lot of experts here. So Jenkins was our continuous integration tool that we have been using. We are one of the early adopters of Jenkins, and we have been using it for a couple of years now. And initially, we started using a single Jenkins instance for the whole company. So people, developers would come there and create their jobs and run their integration or automation tests. So this one Jenkins instance had around 40,000 runnable jobs, and it used to run 30,000 builds every day. And we had different stacks in PayPal. So we had Java, Node, Python, C++, and whatnot. And so this one Jenkins master used to have hundreds of slaves connected to it. And we had a custom build system in PayPal, which used to build 50 million lines of code in less than 1 minute. So this one giant Jenkins instance, we had a lot of limitations with that. It worked to an extent, but it had a lot of limitations, like it was a single point of failure. So when something goes wrong, the entire company is affected. Whoever is building their jobs, it would get aborted, and they have to start over again. And it wasn't scalable. And change management was very difficult. I mean, if we have to upgrade Jenkins, or if we need to put a plugin onto our Jenkins instance, we had to restart the Jenkins instance where all the developers would get affected. And there was no freedom for users. This is the main point. I mean, developers won't be able to upgrade their plugins themselves, or if they want to do something, upgrade Jenkins or plugins, they won't be able to do that. And the nodes, I told you about hundreds of nodes connected to Jenkins master in the previous slide. The hundreds of nodes, Jenkins used to do resource management to an extent, but still, even if there are nodes that are running in Jenkins, the nodes are still connected to the Jenkins instance, and the resources would be idle during that time. It could be used for some other workload other than CI if they are idle, so which wasn't happening with a single Jenkins instance. And plugins, so Jenkins is a very good in the aspect that it supports plugin. So if you want to customize your Jenkins instance, you can write your own plugin and put it on top of it. But the most of the plugins that are available for Jenkins weren't able to scale up to the level we were using. We were one of the biggest Jenkins instances with 40,000 jobs, so most of the plugins don't scale. For example, we had an issue with Cobachura plugin. So it used to run out of memory often, and we had to remove it. And so, So we came up with, so due to the limitations with one Jenkins instance, we came up with another model where we had a dedicated virtual machine for each Jenkins instance. So if you are a developer and if you onboard to PayPal, and if you want to create your own application, you would get a Jenkins instance on a virtual machine on top of it. So this virtual machine will have two executors in it. So you don't have distributed slaves. The master would behave as a slave. It will have two executors, and it will be able to do your builds. But this users loved it, actually, because they had their freedom to upgrade plugins or upgrade their Jenkins instance. But as DevOps, what we saw was that resources were not properly utilized. Out of this, I mean, at one point we saw that 2,500 virtual machines were created like that. Out of this 2,500, only 10% were really used. Out of this 10%, only it used builds only once or twice a day, which means the rest of the time the resources were idle. And if you think about 2,500 virtual machines, it's millions of dollars invested on hardware. So although it solved the problem of freedom for users and removed the single point of failure, we still had the resource management issue where we didn't use the resource optimally. So that is when we explored Mesos. So with Mesos, what we did was we created a lightweight Jenkins master with just 0.2 CPUs and 256 megabytes of RAM. So it won't build anything by itself. It is just Jenkins master. And Jenkins slave also will be provisioned out of Mesos. That is using Jenkins Mesos plugin. And this is done only when there is a demand. So when a user goes and clicks on build his job or the SCM triggers his job, the job goes into Jenkins queue. That is when Jenkins Mesos plugin will request for resources from Mesos, and Mesos will send back the resource offers. And if Jenkins gets an offer that matches the slave requirements, it will create a slave and it will do the build. So after the build is complete, there is an idle timeout. After the idle timeout, the resources will be given back to Mesos. So we used Marathon Scheduler for spawning Jenkins Master. So Jenkins Master by itself was a long-running task. It will be up and running all the time. So whenever it goes down, Marathon used to respawn it in some other virtual machine, and it will be up and running all the time. So with Mesos, we were able to utilize resources optimally. I mean, the build slaves which require more compute are only provisioned on demand when the build goes into queue. So this has given us optimized resource utilization. And the other point is our operating cost reduced to 10x times. So with 2,500 virtual machines, we were using approximately 24,000 CPUs. Now, with Mesos, we were able to solve the same problem with 2,400 CPUs. And there were 180 terabytes of disk before Mesos and 18 terabytes of disk after Mesos. And the RAM also went down 10x times. If you see the image, actually, these guys are trying to recover from a tire burst. They are trying to change the tire. So this is how we used to operate without Mesos. So when the virtual machine hosting Jenkins goes down, people would raise a ticket, and we would go in there and provision a virtual machine for them, which is going to take a couple of minutes, and then take the backup from the file system and put it on that, and then recover it, which took a long time, actually, hours for it to recover. Now, with Mesos, recovery was like this, where it was instant. I mean, when the Jenkins instance goes down on one virtual machine, so Marathon, if the virtual machine which is hosting the Jenkins goes down, Marathon will automatically respawn it in another virtual machine. So which worked well for us. But the problem we had was the CA workload was too much for a Marathon. So the way we were using Marathon was like we used one application for each Jenkins instance. So up to 500 apps, it was perfectly fine. It was able to handle it. But after 500 apps, Marathon used to go down. I mean, even it had high availability, but we had issues with keeping it up all the time. We had to manually intervene and bring up the quorum, Marathon quorum again. So that is when we went for Aurora. So Aurora, when we did our testing, so it was able to handle more than 5,000 jobs and be stable. And we, when we replaced Marathon with Aurora in our cluster, it was actually during the cluster was alive and no user impact. So we just replaced it on the fly. So this is a whole architecture. So how did you get the question?
Yeah. So using Marathon or Aurora, you should be able to schedule jobs. They can be long living, or there could be multiple instances of the job running. It could be periodic jobs too. You can use the both Marathon as well as Aurora for the same purpose. But Aurora is more rich in that you can, based on if a job dies, what do you do? So in that sense, Aurora is more rich. For our purpose, both Marathon and Aurora for the functionality, it works.
So just adding to that point, Marathon community is very good. So they are adding features, very active, and they are adding features very actively. So for example, the Docker support in Marathon was added way back than Aurora. But for stability, for our specific use case, Aurora worked very well, more than Marathon. Okay. Okay, so this, I'm just going through the architecture, how we do our continuous integration with Mesos. So CA API is the application which would actually be the REST interface for our customer, which is another tool which is going to serve as user interface for the user. So he'll be able to create an application and create a CA and associate to his application. So basically this, when a user requests a CA through the user interface, the request would come to CA API. And CA API would in turn request Jenkins instance to Aurora. And Aurora is a scheduler which will be receiving resource offers from Mesos master. So when Aurora finds a resource offer which is good enough to create a CA, so it will spawn a CA instance. I mean, choose the resource offer and ask Mesos to spawn the Jenkins instance. So that will in turn go to Jenkins slave, and your Jenkins master will be provisioned. Now, so Zookeeper, we use it for high availability and master, Mesos master election. So Aurora also supports high availability. So it uses Zookeeper for leader election. And so whenever the Jenkins master comes up, it talks back to CA API and tells that, hey, I'm up on this host name and port. And CA API basically puts a mapping in Nginx with the Rivex proxy URL so that users don't have to remember the host name port. So they, for them, it will be myca.papercup.com/mycaname. Now we use MongoDB for the storage, persistent storage, and so shift storage we use to back up our Jenkins master. So So if a VM goes down and if the Jenkins master instance is spawned in any other VM, it will use the backup from shift storage, which is done periodically, and it will spawn the new Jenkins instance. So for Jenkins, all the state is stored in file system. So we just need to backup the Jenkins home directory in the shift storage for it to recover later if there is a failover. And for Jenkins slave use case, so whenever user triggers a build, Jenkins Mesos plugin will be used to provision a slave. And if there are any slaves, resource offers from Mesos master that is matching the requirement, it will choose that offer and provision a slave. So once the build is done, again, the slave resource will be given back to Mesos master. So that is pretty much on how we operated with Mesos and Mesos and Jenkins. So Soma will be covering the part where we had challenges, other challenges after Mesos, and how we efficiently operated with Docker. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, Mani. Good evening, everyone. So using Mesos, we have been able to attain efficiency. We have been able to run the whole cluster, CI cluster, with less resource in optimal fashion. But still, there were like few challenges. Let me go through them. So when you look at the picture on the left top, this is the common problem everyone, every DevOps will be facing. So the developer comes in and says that, okay, my build is actually working on my laptop, but it's failing on the build system. That's when we come in and say that, okay, how do we solve this issue, right? We either have to go to the developer workstation, look at it, and see, oh, there's something wrong over there. So most of the cases, what we found was the environment on the laptop or the workstation is quite different from the environment we will generally have on our build system. So that's one issue which we have to handle. Even when we are using Mesos, there were certain resources that has to be shared among multiple processes, multiple tasks. For instance, there are a couple of builds happening on the same VM. They'll be sharing the same Maven settings.xml. They'll be sharing the same Maven repo. They have the capability to run into each other. We have seen cases where task builds were running into each other. That was another issue. And PayPal being such a huge company, we had such a huge, big developer base, and we have a lot of technologies being used internally. As Mani mentioned, we develop in Java, Node, Scala, C++, everything, all of those stacks. And there are pockets of developers who also go and develop in Go. So we have to address all of those teams, the build system for all of those teams. But different technology stacks will have their own requirements, the tool set they want to use. So there were cases where the tool set used by one technology were not really compatible with the other technology. So we had to resolve them. And in certain cases where we pushed a particular tool to production, that was actually breaking a build of a different technology stack. So that's another thing which we wanted to solve. The other thing was, yeah, as Mani mentioned, we were able to efficiently use the Mesos cluster, but we wanted Ubuntu 14.04. That's the requirement for us. We had our own tool set. As against some other teams like staging, they have their own requirements. They need their own set of tool set. We can't really run the whole of workload on the same cluster because of this issue. We tried to run it, but we were able to have a single Mesos master, Zookeeper, or Aurora code up. But the VMs itself where the workload runs has to be different. We tried to attain this by using constraints. But that was not really the efficient way because we were fragmenting the whole resources. The other thing was, as I mentioned, there were different technology stacks across PayPal. And let's say if some technology stack, they want to push in some tool, it was a kind of slow process where they need to open a ticket, they need to ask us to deploy the tool, test the tool. We would go ahead and test it out, ensure that the functionality is working as expected. But at the same time, we want to ensure that no other technology stack build is breaking. So that was a kind of a slow process. We really want to be out of those decisions because that's really what frameworks they would take care of. And the other case was inconsistent build environments. With Mesos, in order to maintain the state of the VM, whenever we have to do any changes, we used to use Ansible for our change management. For most of the cases, it worked great, but there were instances where some of the VMs were not having certain toolset, because when the change was rolled out, that probably the VM was down. So when there were issues, we had to go to the VMs and look at it and see what is missing. There used to be cases where the latest set of tool changes were not pushed in, or in certain other cases, it was kind of extreme and rare, but still we've seen where old changes were not there. So that was kind of totally distressing. We wanted to fix all of these issues. That's when we started looking at Docker and containerization. And we, after looking and studying it, we decided that Docker is the right tool for most of these problems, not for everything, for most of them. So what does Docker provide? Why do we want to use Docker? One is task isolation. Once you run your build inside a Docker container, the build is constrained to that container itself. It doesn't have access to the external to the container. We restrict it, so it doesn't violate anyone else. So that's provided task isolation for us. And the other thing was, whenever we were doing builds, there was a level of inconfidence where the VM could be not in up-to-date state. But going with Docker, we pretty much sure that, okay, this is the particular image, Docker image we want to use for our build, and that's what we are using. Let's say a team comes and says that the build is not working. We can right away go and see what image is being used, whether it's the latest one or an older one. At that point, we have good understanding what's wrong. In that sense, Docker was very much helpful. It also eliminates the dependency on the host, because you're defining your environment within the container as a Docker image itself, so you don't rely on the host at all. You define your own environment. It was also helpful in reproducibility. As I mentioned earlier, there were cases where the user comes in and says that my build is not working on the CI, but it was perfectly fine on my laptop. So with Docker, we can reproduce an issue. Let's say the developer goes and builds it in the container from the Docker image with the right set of inputs, and if they are able to reproduce the issue, we should be able to take the same container image, same set of inputs, and be able to reproduce on our CI system. That's very helpful. The other case was portability. As we can use Docker images and the Docker containers, we don't really care what is the host OS itself. We should be able to run the Docker containers on any host as long as it supports Docker. The other good feature about Docker is immutability. Earlier, we were pushing the changes through Ansible to the VMs, but that was not really fail-proof. With Docker, if there are any changes to be pushed, I would just go ahead and create a Docker image and configure the jobs or the CIs to use the new Docker image, and that's pretty much. Either I'm using a particular new Docker image or the old one. There is no context of losing something. And that also provides me with an opportunity where I can set up a homogeneous cluster with a single OS across the board and have different workloads run on the cluster. It could be CI workload, it could be staging workload, it could be something else. As long as they define their Docker image, they are good with it. So that was very easy for us to manage. This helped us solve most of the issues we had before Docker. So once we decided that Docker is the way to go, we started Dockerizing most of our applications, almost all. We have Dockerized CI API, which is our orchestration engine, which takes in the CI provisioning request, creates the CI, and provides the CI to the user. We have Dockerized the Jenkins master. We have Dockerized Jenkins slave. So everything is running in Jenkins in Docker, so that we don't really rely anything on the host, and it's very easy from our maintenance perspective. The Docker image which we use for Jenkins master, it's immutable. If you have to roll out a change, we just reprovision the CIs with a new Docker image, and that's pretty much. We are sure that all the changes are in there. It also eliminates the need for some tool to go into the VM or to the tool itself and install any of those tools. So you can just have your Docker image and that will take care of it. It provides task isolation. There is no context of one user actually violating the other user. And the last but not the least, the thing is, with using Docker, we can accommodate other workloads in the same cluster. We don't have to worry about whether it's compatible or not. Coming to Dockerizing Jenkins Slave, we were able to support multiple tool sets, multiple stacks, with the users and the teams providing their own Docker images. That's very helpful. It was easy to roll out any changes because I don't have to worry about a new tool for a particular stack is impacting any other stack. I don't have to worry about it. And as I mentioned earlier, with VMs, rolling out a particular tool is a very slow process. As against on Docker, the user can create their own images. For instance, Go. Go is a small community in at PayPal. They can create their own Docker images for their Jenkins slave, and they be able to build it after a certification process from our end, which is very much automated. So that's where it was fastened the whole process. So once we Dockerized all of our systems, we have to change our processes in order to accommodate the Dockerization. For instance, earlier, we were putting our SSH keys, tokens, SSH keys for, let's say, GitHub access or tokens for DTR access, Maven credentials. They were on the disk itself. With Dockerization, we moved out from the disk, and we started providing these inputs at runtime, at build time itself. We will just inject them. And every few days, we will rotate the keys also so that they are secure. Even if they are compromised, the damage is limited. And again, as I mentioned earlier, the JDK, Maven, all of the toolset, we don't really need to install on the host. They will be part of the Docker container, and it's up to the technology stack to take care of it, and they are responsible, and they have the freedom to make a choice. So using Docker, we have resolved most of the issues, as I mentioned earlier, but there was still an issue. So at PayPal, the environment is development environment is really fast-paced. The user will expect the build times to be very fast. So if you look at a typical developer, he will clone the repository for the first time, and he will do a build. Let's say if you take a Maven build, the first Maven will download all the artifacts, and it will be cached. Any subsequent build will only download the delta. So let's say if you take a typical Maven build, the clone, Git clone, might take about like 27 seconds, and Maven build, which includes downloading the Maven artifacts from Nexus, takes about 3 minutes. Overall, let's say the typical build takes 4 minutes. But if the developer does the second build with very minimal change to the code, he doesn't have to download all the artifacts. He doesn't have to fetch the code. The build time comes down from 4 minutes to less than 20 seconds. So the developer will expect same performance even from CI. But the challenge here is because we are running on Mesos and using Docker, we are not really sure where the build will end up. The first build can end up on like XYZ machine. The second build may be totally entirely different on a different machine. So the clone process and the download for artifacts have to happen again. That was not a great experience, and there were a lot of complaints from the users, which is understandable. So in order to address this issue, we try to solve this problem by implementing our own solution. We have one of the most biggest OpenStack installation. We call it as C3. C3 has uses block storage. They call it as Cinder. So we try to use the Cinder technology for moving the storage from machine to machine. We would attach and detach the storage as the build moves from one VM to the other, so that at the end of the build, we just detach this storage. And for the next build, we just attach this storage so that the storage is still available and everything is cached. So we solved this problem for Cinder, but we are still exploring open source solutions like Flocker and Rexray. Portworx is another solution. We are exploring because we want to have a generic solution for, let's say, on-premise cloud or even Google Cloud or AWS public cloud, we should be free to move from one cloud provider to other cloud provider if you want to. So we are exploring those options. But this is still an open issue which we are working on. So with me running our system on Mesos and running using Docker containers, this is how our system architecture looks like. So when you look here, this is our control zone where the Mesos master, Zookeeper, Aurora, all of our tool sets sit. The data zone, this is where all of our Mesos slave reside. Everything here is Mesos, and everything runs should be Dockerized. And we have other zones for our repositories and other zones for databases. So the way flow works in here, as Mani has already explained, Altus is our front end for our developer community. For their app creation or for CI creation or deploying their applications to the staging environment, they go through Altus. For CI provisioning, they come to Altus, request a CI provisioning. Altus, in turn, requests our endpoint. This is the load balancer, ci.paypalcorp.com. This is the load balancer, which is front-ending our CI API cluster, which is Dockerized, and just forwards the request. It's just a load balancer. The request goes in, and CI API takes care of the request. CI API orchestrates the request. It works with Aurora. It creates the Aurora job based on a template, starts up the Aurora job. Aurora, in turn, works with Jenkins Mesos master, gets the resource, and starts up the Jenkins master. Once Jenkins master is up and running, CI API defines the Vantu URL. For instance, it could be ci.paypalcorp.com/cinm and provides this Vantu URL to the users. This Vantu URL is used by the users subsequently. Even if a VM goes down or if the CI has to move from one VM to other, CI API takes care of the orchestration and reconfigures the Vantu URL so that the user doesn't have to worry about where the CI is running. And each CI works with Jenkins Mesos master to get the resource for their build activity. So this is where we are right now. So I'm going to go ahead with the demo of how things will work. I can go into the details of how we configure the Docker images, what Docker commands we run, and we can show where how they are running. So as I mentioned here, Altus makes a REST API request, so ci.paypalcorp.com. I'm going to simulate that request because Altus is not accessible from here. It's our internal tool. So this is a simple REST request with CI API, V1, CI, and this is the CI name. I can just say 2. And this is a POST request. As part of the request, I can define what is my application, who is the owner of the application, what kind of technology stack this application belongs to, what is the GitHub URL of this application. So I just put in a POST request. The response of 201 indicates that the request is accepted and is being processed by CI API. Using the same endpoint, I will be able to get the status of the CI. It would be a GET request. So when you look at the response from the GET request, you can see that status code is 131. 131 indicates that CI API is working with Aurora in starting up the Aurora job, and the compute is not available yet. If I go to Aurora, so this is the Aurora UI, I can see the Aurora job here. It's available. And let's see if it got spawned at Mesos. Yes, it got spawned at Mesos. I can look at the logs by going to Sandbox. From here, I can look at what is going on in detail. It will download the backup and try to start up the Jenkins process. It's already starting the Java process. So let me go back and see what's the status of the CI from CIAP context. Let me put in a GET request. I see it's 150, still in provisioning state. So meanwhile, the provisioning is happening. Let me show you what is the Docker command we use for starting up our CIAP, which is our orchestration engine. So we start the Docker container, and we provide all the inputs, whatever are needed, the certificates, tokens, SSH keys, everything. We do it one time as a manual thing. This is how we inject the secrets. This will start up the CIAP container. Let's look at the status now. The status now changed to 180. 180 indicates that the CI is created and it's ready to be used. Now let me go and start up the access the CI. So we use SSO for our authentication. It authenticates and it lands me on the home page. So as I mentioned earlier, these are the jobs which we use for our continuous integration process. These jobs are triggered whenever there's a pull request. So we can look at the configuration. So we provide all the inputs and configure it to be run whenever there's a GitHub pull request raised. And this CI is configured to run whenever there's a new commit on the base repo. It will check for a new commit every 5 minutes. So when you look at it, the CI, the job is already triggered for the initial base commit. Let me go to Mesos and see what's happening. So when you look at Mesos, you can see that the CI has registered itself as a framework at Mesos, which means that the CI will get offers. And the CI will grab these offers and start up the build. So the offers are not yet there. Let's monitor the task. The task will show up when it's started. So as you can see here, at Mesos, you see the task get started. This is a slave task. And the build uses this slave, which is created dynamically, to start up the build. And it runs inside the container. So this is how the build happens. Whenever this is the whole end-to-end from CI provisioning till the build. So that's pretty much from our end. So we can take any questions if you have.
Yeah, sure. How do you deal with building Docker
images? That's a good question. So we had a similar challenge to build Docker images within Docker. Right now we are using, if you can look at here, we are sharing the socket, which is used by the Docker daemon. That's how we are doing right now. We would like to have a better approach. We are still exploring, but right now this is how it is.
I was going to ask a similar thing. I've seen the original eBay post about some of the exploration stuff, and I was just in the talk that Sunil gave from Mesosphere, where it seems like they've actually gone back to running Docker in Docker, even though it seemed like there were some problems with volumes and so forth. So I'd be curious, maybe to follow up later, about what you guys are exploring as another option. Because we've done the same thing where we're bind mounting it up into the container and using it, but it just seems like there's a lot of security problems or whatnot.
Yes. Yeah, that's still an open question we want to explore. That's an unsolved problem for us.
Yeah. So which version of Marathon are we using right
That was like about 1.5 years back?
Yeah, 0.6.0, I believe.
Definitely.
Yeah.
We are actually working with Benjamin in trying to resolve this issue. It's scalable, I mean, to a larger extent right now. Because we are started with Aurora and it's working pretty fine, so we haven't started exploring Marathon, but that's a different track we are working on right now. We would get to that. And I actually like DCOS concept, that's another thing which we want to explore, but because we have it already in production, it takes inertia. Right now, we are not at 2, but we would move to Jenkins 2 pretty soon. Money can take it.
Yeah, actually, right now we are using local disk to store all the file system data. So Docker, with respect to Docker, you can talk.
So even with Docker right now, we are backing up to object storage and downloading it, restoring it at the start of the Docker container itself. But we want to explore better options. For instance, the stateful containers, right? If that story is solved, we are still exploring Flocker, the X-ray port works. If that is solved, we can just mount and unmount EBS volume, if it's AWS or any block storage.
Using it as like volume drivers.
Exactly. That's still an open question. Right now, we are still going out with backup to object storage. The benefit of getting a, it's not from a build perspective. The Jenkins master itself is tied to the application. So every application will have its Jenkins master. Each Jenkins master will have multiple jobs. That provides the flexibility for the users to have their own plugins, Jenkins plugins, or if they want their own Jenkins Docker image for their build. So that provides the flexibility for them, still being efficient at our end.
Yeah, for example, if they want to upgrade to Jenkins 2.0, they can do it.
Yes.
Do you find that any users actually start creating their own, like the, in the Mesos cloud config, have multiple slaves configured?
Mm-hmm.
Do they end up doing that themselves, or do you generally try to have like one-to-one mapping? Meaning like you could have different flavors of slaves based mm-hmm. off which image you want to start.
Mm-hmm.
Do users end up managing that themselves?
Right now, we haven't seen this, and with Docker, I don't see any reason to do that, because the only thing they would want to have different flavors would be the CPU and the RAM. Otherwise, it's going to be Docker image. Yes, of course, yeah, you're right in the sense that they might want to use different Docker images for different jobs. We haven't seen that use case till now, but that's a possibility.
Customize that with whatever you feel like. So mm-hmm. if you're making a Rails app or a Node app or whatnot, you put your dependencies in there.
Mm-hmm.
So you're kind of running your tests in the agent, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
But that means that you, for any of the app developers out there, they've got to manage both the containerized version of their app, if they're doing containers, and also one that represents the build environment. Instead of perhaps doing it all in one Docker image and like testing an image.
Yeah. So right now, all of these Docker images are created by the technology framework teams. So there are very rare cases where the individual teams or users would want to have their own image. Because we have streamlined stacks for, let's say, Java, Scala, or Node. So the frameworks team responsible for those stacks takes care of the build environment. Because that includes tools for, let's say, running Fortify. So they actually don't need to go into the application itself when they deploy. So they are totally different things. We build them inside the container, and we create a Docker image that will be published and subsequently deployed to the environment, staging environment, on the same Mesos cluster. So right now we are not providing access for the users, but we are looking at options because Docker using for our CI is one use case. The other use case is the users want to run their own jobs, their own, let's say, cron jobs or some processes, which is independent of the build system. They want to get access to it. So that's something which we are exploring. I think it's time out. We can take questions offline. Thank you, guys.